of this half an hour is going to be discuss the management of herpes zoster ophthalmicus. We'll also understand what is the role of microbiology in the management of corneal infections. We'll touch upon the antibiotic of choice and then also the role of corticosteroids in the management of corneal ulcers. I'll touch upon some knowledge that we have gained in past 5 years related to management of fungal corneal ulcers. You must be thinking why I'm talking only of corneal infection. To break the monotony, we'll also look at how do we make differential diagnosis of ectatic corneal disorders and what are the differences in different corneal dystrophies. I hope I'll be able to cover, but that responsibility of listening to all the sections of this talk depends on you. How quickly you are able to respond to the question that I am going to ask. Can I have cordless mic also? Not this, one more. It's not advancing. Can you advance? Yeah. So let us look at this case. A 58-year-old male presented with the history of redness, pain, watering, and defective vision of 20 days duration. Patient had painful lesions on the left side of the face 5 years before the onset of this problem. Visual acuity was counting finger half meters. Is not working the advance. What is the diagnosis? Herpes zoster ophthalmicus. Okay, great. Why it is herpes zoster ophthalmicus? Because of the presence of depressed lesions which are restricted to the one half of. None of these lesions are crossing the other side of the midline. Great. Can you advance? It's not working. What is the pathophysiology of this lesion? Why herpes zoster ophthalmicus occur? So this is caused by varicella zoster virus. They remain dormant in the ganglion, dorsal ganglia. And when the immunity drops, these viral particles start multiplying, then move along the sensory nerves and reach to the representative dermatome. And there they cause lesions because of the local inflammatory responses. And therefore these lesions are painful. Okay. Now the question is, what is Hutchinson's sign before we move on to the management? So if the tip of the nose, tip and the side of the nose is involved, even if patient is not able to open the eye, you can make an impression that this patient will have ocular involvement or this patient will have corneal involvement. So that's what is a very useful sign. Any patient who is not able to open the eye and presented to you with acute symptoms and you are seeing lesions which are involving side of the nose and the tip of the nose, you can make an impression that this patient will be having ocular manifestation or ocular signs. How will you treat this patient? Disappointing. How will you treat this patient? Oral acyclovir. This patient, I am talking of this patient who had episode of skin lesions 5 years earlier. What is the role of oral acyclovir in this patient? Is the corneal lesion that you are seeing on the slide caused by replicating viruses? The answer is no. Okay, and that's why it is important that we also understand the pathophysiology. I am very, very sorry that things are not working. Now they look like, So the important aspects that you have to keep in mind in order to understand the management of this condition is, because of the presence of hypopyon, there is a substantial suspicion that there is infection, secondary infection, and therefore you must make sure that the patient is not suffering from an infectious disease. And the way that you do that is by performing corneal scraping and excluding infection. But what if the microbiology is negative? What explains the presence of hypopyon or the infiltrate? What is the cause of this lesion? So a patient who has epithelial breakdown can develop corneal inflammation, and the corneal inflammation in turn will lead to uveitis and hypopyon. Okay, so remember that presence of hypopyon does not indicate infection all the time. It can be sterile. Okay, now the next aspect to understand is that it is because of the epithelial breakdown, and therefore if you promote epithelial healing, these patients will start showing a response. But how will you control inflammation? Once the epithelial defect start healing, you will add corticosteroid, and that will bring down the inflammation. So to summarize, rule out infection, protect and promote epithelial healing if the microbiology is negative, and for that you need to do tarsorrhaphy. You can add plenty of lubricants in the management of these patients. And as soon as you start seeing closure of epithelial defect, you can add corticosteroid. Why do we not start corticosteroid right from the start of the management? In the presence of persistent epithelial defect, corticosteroids act as a double-edged sword. At one end, they control inflammation, but at the other end, they are preventing collagen synthesis, and therefore the collagenolysis that is going on will lead to corneal melt and corneal perforation. So in a patient of persistent epithelial defect, you should not use corticosteroids loosely. Only when you have seen epithelial defect healing, then you can add corticosteroid, because a persistent inflammation will also be a deterrent to the epithelial healing. Is that point clear? This is very, very crucial in patients of herpes zoster ophthalmicus, because they have neurotrophic cornea, the corneal epithelial defect is not healing. If you use injudiciously corticosteroids or continue to administer antibiotics, the cornea will continue to melt and perforate, and many of these eyes are lost because of the corneal perforation. What are other complications of herpes zoster ophthalmicus? Because if there is a patient of herpes zoster ophthalmicus in ward, you will definitely be given that case in your long, as a long case. So what are the complications? Other complication, I showed you one, which is corneal ulcer. What are other complications? Glaucoma, iridocyclitis, what else? Neuralgia. Neuralgia is not a feature at that stage. What other complication this patient can have? Scleritis, very good. So practically herpes zoster ophthalmicus can cause inflammation of all the structures of the eye. You name and you will find herpes zoster ophthalmicus as one of the causes of inflammation. So iridocyclitis in addition to keratitis, chorioretinitis, optic neuritis, scleritis, and even the orbital cellulitis. So it can cause inflammation in all the structures of the eye. So these are all complications of herpes zoster ophthalmicus, and you have to be watchful of these complications in a patient with herpes zoster ophthalmicus. I think I made a mistake of Let us move on to the second scenario. This is a patient, 35-year male, presented with the painful red eye and denied any history of trauma. However, the patient had undergone dacryocystorhinostomy and then developed this lesion on the cornea. How will you treat this patient? Will you start antibiotics without knowing the cause of infection, or you will do corneal scraping, do the detailed microbiology workup, and then start treatment? What will be the philosophy in the management of this case? Silence. The patient will run away from your clinic if you remain silent. So this is a debate that often we come across. If you pull out any textbook, they say that every patient of corneal ulcer should have a corneal scraping and detailed microbiology workup. Whereas in practice, what you see in your residency programs, that not many patients undergo microbiology. Even if they are undergoing microbiology, the microbiology is negative in most cases. And therefore you feel like, why should I do the corneal scraping in this patient? But you must realize that although there are clinical signs that can help you identify the causative organism or the etiology, there is a lot of overlap of these clinical signs. And therefore, standard textbook or standard practice is that if you have access to microbiology, you must do a detailed microbiology workup of every patient of corneal ulcer, so that you are giving a directed therapy. But since this practice is not very common and many of you might not have access to microbiology workup, the World Health Organization Southeast Asia region group had a meeting in 2005 and made a recommendation, which subsequently were also substantiated by AAO preferred practice. So what it says, that there are different philosophies when you deal with a small ulcer versus a large ulcer. What they recommended is that if the keratitis is involving center of the cornea, is large, or is extending into the posterior one-third of the corneal stroma. In addition, if the corneal signs are suggestive of atypical nature, or patient has not responded to your initial management, then all these patients should definitely have a microbiology, detailed microbiology workup. Whereas if the lesion is small, peripheral, restricted to anterior one-third or two-third of the corneal stroma, these patients can be treated empirically with a broad spectrum antibiotic. Is that clear? So where will you strongly recommend microbiology are these cases: large ulcer, central ulcer, posterior one-third of the stroma is involved, or patient has atypical features, then you should do microbiology. So this is exactly what is the role of microbiology in that. How you do corneal scraping? You should use 15 number surgical blade. Why we say 15 number surgical blade or Kimura's spatula? Because if you use a sharp object, 26 gauge needle or 11 number blade, the cornea is necrotic, and what you will lead to? You may perforate cornea. Whereas the blunt end of 15 number surgical blade or Kimura's spatula are good. They just scrape the surface without having risk of perforation. Crescent knife will have a logistic problem of how will you, because it is a right angle thing, and as you take it, then it will cause problem. What are different media or slides that you use are shown here, one for Gram stain, one for KOH, and if you want to know cellular morphology, you can use it for ZIMSA. So three glass slides, then two media for bacterial growth, blood agar and chocolate agar, two media for fungal growth, sebro dextrose and potato dextrose, And in addition, if you have suspicion of acanth amoeba, you will use non-nutrient agar and then subsequently overlay it with Escherichia coli. Some of the people use liquid media, because if the patient is treated with antibiotic, there is load of antibiotic that get inoculated. You want to dilute that by immersing the specimen in liquid media. So these are different media. You need not use all of them. One bacterial, one fungal, one liquid media also is good way forward if you do not want to inoculate so many media. Now suppose this is the patient that we talked about. Your microbiology showed gram positive cocci. How will you start treatment of this patient? What will be your antibiotic of choice? Cephalosporins. Okay. Will you use it in what concentration? So fortified. Now this, the question that comes, why we do not use fortified antibiotic? Why there is a lot of thrust on fluoroquinolones? Most of the prescription you will find moxifloxacin, gatifloxacin. You very rarely find fortified cefazolin, fortified tobramycin. Why? What's the problem? The advantages with the fluoroquinolones is they are commercially available. You have to just write prescription and person can go and buy in any pharmacy. Are fortified antibiotics available like that? No, they are not available. Number two, there are no issues with the shelf life. These fluoroquinolones are safe to be used for 1 month. Whereas fortified antibiotics should be discarded in 48 hours to 1 week. You cannot keep them using even beyond that. And some of the fortified drops will discolor on storage at room temperature. So there are issues with the shelf life. Fortified antibiotics are highly concentrated. There are issues with pH. There are issues with their tonicity. So they can become toxic. Whereas fluoroquinolones in the concentration that is dispensed in the market are safe antibiotic. So therefore the fluoroquinolones became very popular as a mean of treatment in the management of corneal ulcers. But what is the philosophy? Which regimen you will use? Will you use fortified antibiotic or fluoroquinolone? What answer will you give as far as that management is concerned? Here again, there are recommendations. If you have a corneal infiltrate which is 2 millimeter or less in size, a small ulcer, then you can start treatment using one of the fluoroquinolones. And it is preferable we use fourth generation fluoroquinolone, for moxifloxacin, gatifloxacin, or basifloxacin. Why? Because the first generation fluoroquinolones have narrow spectrum of activity. They are active only against gram-negative organisms. Their activity against gram-positive organisms is weak. Whereas the fourth generation fluoroquinolones have good activity against gram-positive organism while they retain activity against gram-negative. So they become broad spectrum. But if the patient is having large ulcer as shown here, you must treat with combination of fortified antibiotic. You can here choose an antibiotic which is active against gram-positive organisms and combine it with an antibiotic that is active against gram-negative organism. So a combination of fortified cefazolin with ciprofloxacin or combination of fortified cefazolin with fortified aminoglycoside, gentamicin, tobramycin or amikacin. So that's a combination that you use when you deal with the larger ulcer. So is that point clear as to why when we use fluoroquinolones and when we use a combination therapy? Now remember, antibiotics have to be administered frequently. Frequently means every half an hour. Why we want to use such high frequency doses? Because we want to build corneal concentration as quickly as possible, and this helps eradication of microorganisms. You need to follow the patients closely. You cannot just write prescription and say patient use these drugs and disappear. It is our responsibility to see them back in 48 hours. If the patient is not responding, you
do microbiology if it has not been done, or review the results of microbiology and modify treatment based on the smear and culture results. Antibiotic therapy should be continued only as long as it is necessary. Don't taper antibiotic. The day epithelial defect has healed, you can stop antibiotic abruptly. Okay? So this is another thing that is important. What is the role of antibiotic susceptibility? We do not look at antibiotic susceptibility if the patient is responding. Only in patients who are not responding to your initial line of management, you have to review culture results and you have to review antibiotic susceptibility. So remember that. It's not that your patient is responding, but if the in vitro susceptibility results show resistance, you change different antibiotic. No, there is no need to change antibiotic despite in vitro susceptibility results showing resistance. You can continue the antibiotic to which patient is responding. Now, what is the role of corticosteroid? This topic is very, very important because I think a study conducted at Aravind Eye Care System gave a lot of good insight into use of corticosteroid. They did a very big study and the study found that there was no difference in the patients who were treated with corticosteroid versus those who did not receive corticosteroid, but only antibiotic as far as visual acuity is concerned at the 3-month follow-up. There were no major safety concerns. Earlier we were having fear that if you use corticosteroid, the perforation rates are high, non-healing is very high, but they found that there was no major safety concern. They found that the use of corticosteroid has some advantage in patients who are presenting with severe keratitis, provided we start steroid early as compared to you delay them for a long. Subsequent to this study, there was a Cochrane analysis, and I think I will recommend strongly that you should read that study as well as the Cochrane analysis if you want to understand the whole philosophy of corticosteroid use. And this Cochrane analysis also found that similar findings as were published from the Aravind Eye Care System study. So what you can conclude, corticosteroids have very limited role in the management of bacterial keratitis, okay? And they probably might be having some role in the severe cases. But for safety, if you have not done microbiology, if you are unaware of what is causing corneal ulcer, don't use corticosteroid. Don't use corticosteroids in the management of corneal ulcer. Let us now move on to the fungal corneal ulcer, because this is another important topic. A lot of new research has come and I'm sure you will find it more useful. So this is a 37-year male presented with 3 weeks symptoms and was found to have fungal filaments on KOH calcofluor white. What will be the first line of treatment? What drug will you use? Is it going to be voriconazole? Is it going to be natamycin? Voriconazole. Why voriconazole? It is good that I picked up this topic. Why voriconazole? Why? More expensive drug, better outcome? Is that the philosophy? No. I think it will be important for us to learn that. There are a variety of antifungal drugs. You must know the classification of antifungal drugs. Some of the newer antifungal drugs are azoles and echinoconidins. They have been shown to have better pharmacokinetics, and that's why voriconazole had a honeymoon period. Everybody was talking voriconazole, voriconazole. But the study that again was conducted in Aravind Eye Care System found that voriconazole is as effective as natamycin. It does not offer any advantage. And against some of the fungal organisms, it is rather counterproductive. Patients treated with voriconazole had higher rate of corneal perforation, especially the patients who were having infection with fusarium. Now, subsequent to this study, Cochrane again Cochrane Library conducted a review. They looked at all the studies that have compared voriconazole and natamycin, and they found, yes, the results are almost similar. That voriconazole is not superior to natamycin, and it is rather associated with higher risk of complications in the form of corneal perforation and need for keratoplasty. Now, will you consider intracorneal injection of voriconazole or amphotericin B? Because that is another hot topic that has been discussed in the last 5 years. There are many people who are advocating intracorneal injections. Now, they are useful in some situations where the lesion is central, posterior stroma is involved. And there was a publication from RP Center. Which showed that intracorneal injections are useful. But subsequent to this, they did another study where they found that if you administer voriconazole topically along with natamycin and compare it with voriconazole intrastromal injection and natamycin, they found there was no difference in that. So if you have a patient of fungal infection who is not responding to natamycin, you can add voriconazole topically. And after that study, the intracorneal injections have gone down as far as their uses is concerned. There is one presentation where the patient presents with the raised plaque-like lesions. And in these cases, a superficial keratectomy can help you removing the fungal load. How it does it? If you look at the histology of this presentation, you will find that there is a carpet-like growth. So most of the fungi remain on the surface, and when you do excision, these get removed, and it allows better drug penetration also. So superficial keratectomy is one of the useful ways of management of fungal keratitis. So to conclude, we covered three topics. Natamycin is as good as voriconazole. Intracorneal injections have their role, but that is not necessary. You can add voriconazole to natamycin, that can help. And adjunctive procedures such as keratectomy can help eradicate infection. Let us in last 2 minutes or 3 minutes try to cover some of the differential. What is the diagnosis of this case? What is the diagnosis? What you are seeing here? Thinning. Dendritic lesion. Look at the thinning and ectasia. What is the diagnosis? Keratoconus. Now look at the second case. Again, thinning, ectasia. Terians. What else can be terians like? Pellucid marginal. And what is the difference between terians and pellucid? Associated vascularization and lipid deposit is feature of terians. Absence of vascularization but peripheral location is a feature of pellucid marginal degeneration. So what are differences between pellucid, keratoconus and keratoglobus? All of these three conditions are characterized by ectasia, thinning and protrusion. And I think if you look at carefully slit image of three condition, you will be able to make the diagnosis difference. In keratoconus, thinning is central and the part which is thinned is most ectatic. In pellucid, thinning is peripheral and a cornea which is just central to thinned area is ectatic, and that's why you see crab claw appearance. Okay, in keratoglobus there is a generalized thinning and generalized protrusion. So it is very, very important that you look carefully these corneal cases and make appropriate diagnosis. Don't jump guns and say it is terians. Don't jump guns when you say pellucid as keratoconus. There are other features, I am not going to go into the details, both in terms of the onset, manifestation and topography that you must be aware of. What is this condition? A corneal edema with a cleft in the center in a young 14-year male. It's in high drops. How will you treat this condition? How will you treat this condition? There is no treatment required. You need to reassure patients that it is resolves spontaneously. You just need to give supportive treatment, and most of the times reassurance to parents. It resolves, and many a time it helps contact lens fitting subsequent to resolution, because cornea becomes flatter. And therefore, don't jump and say keratoplasty is the treatment for acute high drops. Keratoplasty is not required. It takes about 8 to 12 weeks for this condition to resolve, and some of the patients do not require keratoplasty after resolution of. So keratoplasty is not the treatment of choice in acute high drops. We'll just look at what is this condition, and I'll close. What is this condition? Generalized opacification of cornea extending from limbus to limbus. No vascularization. Granular dystrophy. Macular dystrophy. Okay. So this is macular corneal dystrophy. We will not go into the detail. Can you go back? I hope it. Advance just one. In contrast, granular corneal dystrophy involves only the central area, and intervening stroma is usually clear. Okay? This is known as TGF-beta dystrophy also. Now, after understanding the genetics of corneal dystrophies, what we have realized is lattice corneal dystrophy and granular corneal dystrophy are because of the mutation in the same gene. And therefore, they have been clubbed together as TGF-beta dystrophies. Whereas macular dystrophy is because of the mutation in a different gene, and it is different material that get deposited in the stroma, and clinical manifestations are different. So you must be aware of these conditions and how to differentiate dystrophy from degeneration. Thank you very much for your patience. I am sorry for technical glitches. I'll need more practice to do lecture like this. Thank you.